gave us a lecture on adjuvant and neoadjuvant therapy. Everything that you wanted to know but were afraid to ask. Now a new opinion. As people say, wisdom comes with the years, with the age, but sometimes the age comes alone. Today I have practically half an hour, and I'm really very happy that we have here quite a lot of people who were present here at that time 5 years ago. And however, I think that now we have a choice of options to consider. And today I am not so sure about methods of treatment that I was so enthusiastic about 5 years ago. Yes, new adjuvant therapy is very effective. It can save a lot of patients, but its effectiveness is not so great. And as soon as I have started thinking about that, this therapy can really cure the patient and surgery may be also not so effective. But I started having doubts about neoadjuvant therapy. This is what I want to share with you, remembering what I have been saying 5 years ago and what I think about it now. Well, adjuvant therapy, what does it mean and how different it is from the common therapeutical model? So far, there is no standard definition of adjuvant therapy. There's been an attempt at explanation. For instance, we can administer adjuvant therapy to the patient who has micrometastasis, which we are unable to see or find, and we may cure the patient. But in fact, if there is something more serious, then the patient will not be cured. And we cannot cure the patient if we are at the macro stage of the disease. But in fact, adjuvant therapy is also the treatment of metastasis, just like common therapy. But we use it to treat only small cells, small cancer tumors, small metastasis, which we cannot find using our naked eye. So we can cure N cells, while if there are N plus 1 cells, we won't be able to cure the patient. Can we explain that in theory? Unfortunately, we know which left who could explain that. However, today, the recommendations, conclusions, which were made before, they do not work so well today. And that is more or less clear. There is a clonal evolution, and generally the approach of the patient to the disease. There may be also cells in the tumor which can be resistant to the administered therapy. So it is not always that adjuvant therapy can be a cure for all. Might be it can serve only to reduce the time before recurrence of the disease. If we see, analyze, for instance, cancer of the mammary gland, we can see that this cancer is always recurrent, and we understand that just like all other neoplasms, the mammary gland cancer can cover quite a number of kinds of cancers, which may be different, which may have different course of survival, and they can be susceptible to therapy in many different ways. And sometimes we can find that patient is still alive just because you didn't check it properly. And finding the proper means for curing. I cannot say anything against the fact that adjuvant therapy may improve survival. I do not understand to the very end how it works. But if it works, we've got to use it. But what kind of a victory we are going to have then? Can we use it with also the pepper and salt? Can we find the tumors which cannot be seen either by CT or with our naked eye using a microscope? The fact that now we have much better options for a systemic treatment, this should bring us a better win than the earlier versions, earlier options of neoadjuvant therapy. But might be that can be explained by the fact that the groups, statistical groups, which now undergo adjuvant treatment, they are not very seldom, because we choose people like this for our treatment. However, if we add pertuzumab in the adjuvant regimen, then we have one set of results, and if we do it on a different stage, we'll get a result which can be completely different. The problem is that adjuvant therapy after surgery, we may know that adjuvant therapy, even if it is highly effective against metastasis, we will have 6% of it. But if we try to start treating a regular patient with adjuvant therapy, it may be that we'll be curing him from what can be done by traditional means. So we overtreat quite a number of patients, and the effectiveness of the adjuvant therapy lies in not in new drugs, because there are already many methods of treatment like that, but actually we cannot distinguish between the poets who may or may not pay for this operation or not. If we have and in this case, there will be more patients with micrometastasis. But for an individual patient, we won't be able to give a direct answer to these questions. There is no data on curing the patients at the macro stage. However, we have still to apply neoadjuvant therapy just because we may not know whether the patient has micrometastasis or not, or might be we can over-treat some of the patients, but refusing to do adjuvant therapy, we may this way sentence to death quite a number of patients who would not receive that treatment and ergo would not survive. This is the diagram showing that we have saved 80 patients using trastuzumab, while to reach this figure, we had to treat 1,700 patients. When we added pertuzumab, we had to treat 24,100 patients. So we see a problem here. We've got to understand that adjuvant therapy can cure a patient, but we have to be very careful not to deprive patients from this therapy, and they have and they may have those microneoplasms which we do not see. If the efficiency is 98% after hormonal therapy, sometimes we think that we should not prescribe chemotherapy because in this case the therapy may be aimed at nothing. So instead of starting chemotherapy, which is very cheap, we can start with tests costing much more than the therapy itself. And all the attempts at attracting patients with monoclonal antibodies, they usually finish with a summary that we have to know more about these medication, about cancers and tumors. However, when we know that the results of adjuvant therapy are practically identical to those with traditional chemotherapy, and we can be proud that we have started with a chemical treatment of this neoplasm. Of course, using modern technology, we may find one cell per billion malignant cell in the blood. And we, of course, can apply neoadjuvant therapy, monoclonal antibodies, to kill these cells. But with solid oncology, when we have a full-scale, well-developed will, we can and we should apply neoadjuvant therapy with colorectal cancer after surgical treatment, because we have much better figure after the resection of colorectal carcinomas. But all these cases, which are shown here, there is not enough actual material when we have tried to apply both kinds of therapies. We have now a list of articles concerning the cancer of the mammary gland, summing up the options like neoadjuvant therapy, when we can very quickly evaluate the progress after adjuvant therapy, but we can subject the patients who are who can demonstrate results of the new medication. And if we have not found anything changes in the cells during the tests, we can roll over, roll back to the old chemotherapy. And we also can evaluate the effectiveness of the therapy in vivo. And the best way to evaluate it, we can judge by the reply of the tumor, and it can be done easily. However, the issue is that this will be only the forecast. The people who do not display any morphological or any other criterion for chewing, he still chewed. But in reality, it is, in fact, whether you choose pre-surgery or post-surgical period, which was at all before. However, this stage, neoadjuvant stage, makes the surgery less radical, especially if you operate on the esophagus, stomach, or bladder. However, first the neoadjuvant therapy was applied to the mammary gland cancer, and there was quite a lot of deliberations on the better survival, and it was much better after metamorphosis, and so we decided that we could choose it based on the metamorphosis. But with this there will be no change in the destiny of the patient. And there may be 50 patients who are susceptible to treatment and 50% who are resistant to treatment. For instance, we treat them, and if we start with chemistry, we can find both the metamorphosis, and we can understand who will be curable and who not. And this is this viewpoint was confirmed by a number of publications describing survival rates in patients with and without neoadjuvant therapy. For me, this is more or less obvious, but it turned out that it was only temporary, because the champions of the neoadjuvant approach, they seem to be right. Before the attempts at assessing the condition of these patients were not successful, but with the patients who did not respond to the therapy, we had to change regimen for them. That was first applied with the osteogenic sarcoma. The patients who had poor metamorphosis, whether they received the adjuvant therapy or they received an enhanced option of adjuvant therapy, with them survival was the same. But here we were guided not by the metamorphosis, but by the clinical response. The adjuvant therapy meant that the patients who do not react promptly to therapy, they were either undergoing treatment or a new treatment or continuing the same treatment for a longer time. With them, nothing has changed. And though there is a trend for better survival without recurrent tumors, nothing has changed. But recently, there was a very important change when nobody was expecting a miracle. The patients with mammary gland cancer who were randomly selected for cabidomycin as adjuvant therapy and we found that there was an absolutely unusual discrepancy between the survival curves. Perhaps we had a population of patients with micrometastasis, and if we tried capecitabine on everyone, perhaps we wouldn't be able to distinguish between those who.
It was an Asian research, and we know that Asians respond to this drug differently. Those are the peculiar feature of their pharmacogenomic. But this approach worked well in other options of breast cancer. The patient who didn't receive complete metamorphosis and those tumors, you know, didn't respond transfusion map, were randomized. For trastuzumab and adjuvant regimen, and we saw, you know, a very brisk, very rapid, and unusual divergence of this curve, and that was a very stable trend, the curve of overall survival. What happened? Well, it was just the right patient subpopulation, and of course, once again, I would like to reiterate, you know, I actually gave up. I don't want to denounce this statement. In breast cancer, it's pretty obvious that neoadjuvant approach is better. Why? Because based on data obtained on analysis of neoadjuvant therapy effect, we can change or modify disease course and change the faith of our patient. If we understand that the patient do not respond to neoadjuvant therapy, so we offer alternative chemo or target therapy, and you know, add number of cured patients, which weren't the case if we wouldn't have done all that. One more common and seemingly useless test, an assessment of the lymph nodes in melanoma. Basically, it was useless because we didn't have efficacious adjuvant therapy, whereas now we just have to modify the algorithm of patient assessment, because you know, presence or absence of this lymph node makes a huge difference. It changes our therapeutic approaches and again change the faith of our patient. I have to skip all that, sorry. You know, I needed more time. But as a matter of fact, neoadjuvant therapy keeps changing. We didn't expect that. It's, you know, a chemo-resistant disease, and it was an axiom, okay, forget your hope and lose your hope, everyone who enters this domain, pancreatic cancer. Even here, we see that they diverging curve. What else is a part of our practice that is not accepted yet? In breast cancer and colorectal cancer, and it's already a part of guideline. Maintaining normal body mass index also reduce the risk of recurrences. But fitness centers will sponsor propagate this information. And to conclude, you know, surgeons and chemotherapists arguments. What does it mean, the adjuvant? You know, addiction, addendum, you know, there are surgeons, and surgeons coined this term. We treat the patient, and you just do something additional. But, you know, now we see the shift of this paradigm in a rectal cancer. For instance, there the chance for patients to escape surgical treatment, and you know that's something sacred. I believe that it's an MD Anderson Center. Well, they ask themselves, do we have to the rate on breast cancer patients who, in fact, had responded to new adjuvant therapy. And now, so the randomized clinical trial is in progress. And also the conclusions. You know, I would like to meet with you again in half a day from now. Thank you very much for your brilliant presentation.